I'm so pleased to be with you all today. Welcome to Austin, for those of you who are from out of town. South by Southwest is known for celebrating creatives and independence of thought, and that's why it's so exciting to have the guest we have here today. Julia Ducournau is not only a groundbreaking new filmmaker, she is also a historically important filmmaker, not just because she is only the second woman to receive the Palme d'Or in Cannes, the prestigious prize, but also because she has pushed the boundaries and limits of the horror genre, allowing for new film language to come forth. So we'll be talking a lot about that today. So prior to her film, Titane, being presented in the main competition at Cannes in 2021, Julia was celebrated for her incredible breakout feature, Raw, which premiered at Critics Week at Cannes and was really a revelation. And from there, it was nominated for six categories at the César Awards, France's Oscars, and her award-winning film prior to that was Junior, a short film, which announced her talent, but also some of the thematic pursuits that would carry on through the next several films. While many French filmmakers have presented work in the U.S., few have broken out in the way Ms. Ducournau has. She has inspired so much discussion about horror as a genre, about gender and representation in film and on screen. So we'll talk about three main films today. Her 2011 film, Junior, in which a pubescent girl goes through a monstrous transformation. Her first solo feature, Raw, in which a young woman develops a thirst for human flesh while in her first semester at veterinary school. And finally, her Palme d'Or winning Titane, where the film's point of departure is a female serial killer with a metal plate in her head who has a one-night stand with an automobile. With that, I'm actually going to share a few words from the film critic, the amazing film critic Justin Chang, about Titane before I bring Julie out. So Titane is an essay etched in rivulets of blood and oil on the mutability of gender and the pliability of desire. It's also a profane hymn to the specific alchemies of fire and metal, to the dark allure of forces that can destroy us no matter how hard we try to bend them to our will. And finally, perhaps, is Ducournau's attempt to turn that very destruction into a creative act, to envision the world collapsing in an unholy trinity of flame, chrome, and flesh, and to pull an improbable and singularly incandescent love story from the wreckage. Ladies and gentlemen, let's bring out Julia Ducournau.
Hello. Thank you.
Such a pleasure to have you back in Austin.
It's my pleasure.
So the point of departure for your films is often the family. So that's going to be our point of departure today. And I want to ask you about, you've talked a bit about your parents in interviews, but I want you to talk a little bit about your role in your nuclear family.
My parents are really tired of hearing me talk about them. And they actually asked me to stop. They're like, enough talking about us. You're 39 now. It's pathetic. And that's right. I mean, it's true. They're right. I'm the youngest child in my nuclear family. So I think from as far as I can remember, I've always found a heaven in storytelling. I remember really, like, I think from the moment I learned how to write, I also learned how to put my thoughts, you know, out. That was the point of all this. And I instantly started to come up with stories, which I did before maybe already, because when my parents would tell me bedtime stories, I would always like plead them to actually create it together instead of just like reading from a book, which I had known already by heart anyway. So I wanted to create the stories with them, which was very difficult for them because they are not storytellers. And I think it was quite a challenge for them, but I always ended up doing the whole story anyway. And and that's the kind of kid I was, you know, like very much in my own head a lot.
And you had siblings?
I have an older sister, yeah, it's the two of us.
Which is sort of the dynamic a little bit in Raw. I mean, assuming you weren't cannibals, but...
Yeah, of course. No, you know, yeah. Well, we have other issues.
So you talk about storytelling with your parents. Your parents were doctors, and can talk a little bit about this in terms of how you deal with the body, but was it a big leap for you to think about yourself as an artist coming from a family where their science and the practice of medicine?
Honestly, yeah, it really was. I mean, even though my parents are very supportive and have always been, I think there was, it's understandable. When I told them that what I wanted to do in life was write, but I had no clue how, you know, what I was going to write and stuff, I think there was like, yeah, a little bit of apprehension of how is she going to just make a living and just be independent and all that. When I told them I wanted to transform that into screenwriting, I think the fear was even bigger. but they have never, forbade me to. They never forbade me to do anything apart from being a doctor. Uh-huh. They always told me, you do whatever you want, but you'll never be a doctor. There is no way. And you know what? I mean, I'm glad I didn't in the end, because it turned out okay for me, right? I mean, as we speak, but I would have been an amazing psychiatrist. I would have loved to do that job. And I still tell them, you know, because of you, maybe I really like took the wrong path for me, because psychiatry is really my thing anyway.
There's still time, but I don't think you should give up your career. If I can,
12 years. It's 12 years in university. I think I'm pretty much done. I mean, thank you, but I'm almost 40, so
still very young in terms of filmmaking years.
Not in terms of doctor's years.
So, you talk about writing and text. When did you make the leap to cinema, and why cinema as your mode?
Well, I did the leap, or I must say the link, more than the leap, quite late. And I'm saying the link because cinema has always been central in my upbringing. I've always watched a lot of old films with my parents. They are very big cinephiles, and it was really for them as important as reading. It was they are big intellectuals, you know. They're really like, culture is everything to them, and I really bless them for that. So it was really music, reading, and watching movies as much as possible. And we had these rituals of watching one film every night, you know. And my mom had this gigantic VHS collection that we would pick in, you know, every time. Like, it's my turn to pick what I want to see. And it's really weird because you're like, I don't know, you can be like 8 and picking a Douglas Sirk movie and you have never heard about it. And it's Imitation of Life, and then you're depressed for the rest of your life. but that's what happened. That was nice. We had this kind of lottery, you know, like, it's your turn to pick. And so basically I thought I wanted to be a writer, and so I kept on doing general studies after I graduated our high school. You know, waiting to see what was coming. I was a major in philosophy and literature and English literature as well. And I heard about this film school in Paris that is a very, very good one. And I insist on the fact that it's a good one because that was part of the bargain with my parents. Like, I want to go to film school, but it's a good one. Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. And they were like, okay. And so I passed the exam because there is a selection, you know, at the entrance. And that's when I got in, and I thought, okay, I'm going to be a screenwriter. But I never thought about becoming a director yet. And by that time, I was like, I think, 18. Mm-hmm. And so in the first year in film school, basically, it's not, everyone is, it's a common area. You know, we're not in our department yet. And so everyone can direct, and you can have like these small digital cameras to rent at the shop in the school and stuff like that. And from the first really shitty little short that I did that didn't even have sound, it was actually like mute. The first time I did that is the first time I realized that I was still writing as I was doing that, like choosing where I would put my camera, directing my actors, directing the entire crew was exactly like writing. And you know, with the years, I also realized that when you're writing, like actually writing in front of your computer, you're already directing as well. Because when I write, I write everything I see in my head, and I think everyone does, you know? Mm-hmm. So I write for every department. I write for the CGI department, I write for the sound department, costume, you name it, you know? And so I'm already directing, and when I'm directing, I'm still writing. So for me, all this is a big, big, nice mess.
I love it. So La Famis is the school that you went to. As you said, it is highly competitive. It's one of the world's best film schools, not just France. What are your strong memories of that period, and what about that experience helped to form you as an artist beyond understanding what it is to direct, but especially as someone, I think, who needs a lot of freedom, from what I can tell?
Yeah, but that's the thing. That's what I liked about that school, is that I got the freedom. We all got the freedom. I mean, you pretty much like created your own freedom within that school, because it's a semi-professional school. So you're not like, you don't have to be constantly in class, and the classes are not theoretical. I mean, we must have had like, I think maybe 4 hours a week of movie analysis. That would be like the most theoretical course we had. But otherwise, it was all about writing and make the other people read what you have written, and then hearing their criticism, and there were tons. And actually, I think like one of the best things that I learned there is how to take criticism, and how constructive it can be, and how you can't be reluctant to criticism if you want to achieve something good or valuable that you can actually communicate to others. You've got to be like receptive to that. And of course, I think that you can be receptive to criticism as far as you know strongly and with a lot of conviction what you want to say. When you have that red thread in your mind, and when you know exactly what you want to say, then you can be open, because you can bring everyone into your idea. You can communicate that idea, explain to them very precisely what you want, and then their criticism is always going to be good. You know, it's always going to make things go forward. So I think that's the best thing that you've heard. Because, you know, it's funny, in La Famis, so we had like, there are as many departments as there are on the set, and also with production and all that. And the people in directing, they had the good life. Mm-hmm. Because people in directing, it's like six of us every year. Each promotion, it's six of us by department, okay? For each department, six students. And the people in directing, they were the stars. They were the stars of the school. It's like you could not tell them anything. They were like genius. Everything they were touching was seen as gold. It was funny, you know, there was this kind of like, yeah, I'm a fucking director, you know, vibe. That was cool to see. But I'm glad I did it in screenwriting, because screenwriting, we were kind of like, obviously, the nerds of the school. But at the same time, we never heard once in 4 years that what we had done was good. Not once. Everything was shit. It was constant shit. All the teachers were always like, "That's not good. I don't get your character. It's meaningless. Just get rid of it. I don't get it. What's the arc of your character? It doesn't move. I mean, it goes from nowhere. You start there and it goes to nowhere. That's bullshit. And everything was like this constantly. And this is so humbling. And at the same time, you learn so much. I'm glad, you know, that no one ever told me in school that that was good. I mean, honestly.
How did you leave with your confidence intact?
Well, again, it's like, generally speaking, you can't like, again, like taking criticism, you can't let criticism crush you. Otherwise, you haven't understood well why you're here. You know, it's part of the process. And if it's part of the process and you accept it as something that's going to push you further, then you can't be crushed. You know, it's like, okay, oh, that script is all shit. Okay, I'm going back from scratch for the next draft and I'm going to do it better. You know?
What film did you make that you knew you had it right, and it was a true expression of your voice and style?
Oh, that's a tricky question. Which film you said? Mm-hmm. Fortunately, I only did three. It's a tricky question, because I love my films in the way that I have a lot of affection for them.
Yeah.
Because I know all the hardship I went through to make them, and all the love that I put in them, and the love that I shared with my crew and my producers that we put in them. So of this, I'm incredibly proud and loving of that process, you know. Of course, I only see what's wrong with them. Mm. Mm-hmm. So I can't tell you, like, I can, what I like is, like, I can tell you that in between films, what I like is noticing a little bit how I evolve and how I evolve as a filmmaker, as a human also, of course, but as a filmmaker. And I see, like, I tend to see what where I feel too comfortable and when I should get out of that and what I can do. I can do that. I know I can do that. I've done that before. Is it a good thing to do that again, though? I'm not sure. You know, and it's always trying to look for the unknown somehow in order, again, to push yourself forward. I think when you feel comfortable is that that's, if you feel too comfortable, it means that your film is going to be shit. I mean, it's really obvious. It's like, if you feel too comfortable, just change your scene, change your character, do something else, go. I mean, be harsh with yourself. Mm-hmm. But what I like is seeing that even when you aim for the unknown constantly, there is a little glimpse of solid and true identity that you can see from one film to the other. That is what they call signature, if you wish, which helps you relate to what you're doing. And that, honestly, that can be in anything. It can be in a commercial as well, for example. Like, you know that, you look at it like, okay, it's a commercial, okay. But I can tell you that's my commercial. Mm-hmm. I can tell that I did it, you know, and it's not, I did not execute someone else's plan. I did it. And that's really rewarding, I think.
Can you talk about the process going from junior into RAW in terms of both the creative process but also getting your first feature together?
From junior to RAW? Going from junior to RAW was actually quite a long time. I think I did junior when I was 26 and I was in Cannes with RAW when I was 32. In between, I did a TV movie that's called Mange, which means both in French, eat or eat dirt. And which was a really strange film, like, man, even for me. I don't see it really connected to the rest that I've done, to be honest. It was a really weird exercise for TV anyway. And so that's why there is this big gap in between junior and RAW. However, coming out of this strange thing that I did for TV, I definitely wanted to go back to what I had started with Justine in junior, because in junior the main character is also Garance and is also called Justine. And I think, like, for me, the thing is that I just want Garance Marillier, who plays the Justine in both films, had grown up, you know, and somehow I wanted to, my character Justine, I was not ready to let her go, and so I wanted her to have grown up as well, because only Garance can play Justine, and she had grown up, so I wanted to see what kind of teenager she was now, and of young woman more than teenager, anyways, and I think I don't know how to say that, but I think that the world got darker for Justine in RAW, because Junior truly was a comedy. I mean, it was dark comedy, it was a gross comedy or whatever, but it still was a comedy. I mean, there was this, like, cute thing with her best friend whom she's in love with and with whom she shares, like, a lot of gross stuff. But it was sweet, you know, and I think that in between, just my vision of the world got darker. Maybe the world itself got darker, I don't know. But it brought me to something that was, a little bit less sweet and a little bit harsher.
And how did RAW come forth? Was it like you had Garance, and so you had the character, and then from the story perspective, was it really connected and things happened quickly, or was it sort of a slog to get through to what the real idea was and what the script would be?
Alors, Garance, yes, was always in my head, for sure. The character, though, was quite hard to... It was hard to write, because, I mean, it's obvious, and I had the same issue with Titan, even though it's reversed in the chronology of the structure of the film. But basically, I want people to relate to someone whom you know is going to commit something that is so incredibly taboo that people are going to reject them normally right away if they see that like that. So how do you get people there? It's not easy. It's not easy, and it's not just like having that cute girl at the beginning and then beam, oh, it's okay, she's still cute. No. And especially though I knew how I wanted to portray that, and I knew how I wanted also to be with her in that moment and not to be just an outside observer of her as she eats that finger, but really to be in her experience, which can definitely trigger, obviously, a lot of rejection on the part of the audience. So how do I make you not judge her for that and make you keep wanting to know more about what's going to happen to her instead of just like giving up and say, oh, she's crazy, I'm leaving the room, you know? So that was a long, a very long process. And I think that's what helped me is that I had no judgment on her. Mm-hmm. I had no judgment on that. Obviously, I did a lot of research on cannibalism, not because I wanted to use it like de facto in my film, but also to experience my own sense of morality. Mm-hmm. You know, so I read a lot of scientific books about it, anthropology, sociology, and stuff like that, about what it means in certain civilization, in certain tribes, in certain part of the country, of the world that I've never been to, and stuff like that. How, like, to have like a broad, let's say, approach of why is this a taboo, and it is, and it should be. And the main reason, obviously, is that it contradicts the idea of evolution for a species, which is the point of a taboo. But how it's interpreted and how it's dealt with, you know, in other times, other space, and all that. And I wanted to myself to be like, to have this full spectrum and knowledge on that, so that I am sure that when she does it, it's her. It's someone that I know and that I don't judge, and to whom, with whom I can anticipate the consequence of that act. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. And try to stay at this level of discovery with her.
I love that the way that your process involves so many questions and sort of responding and moving towards, yes, discovery, answering those questions. That's really incredible. And I love that you brought up this scene with the finger, because I think that scene with the finger is an example of the incredible brilliance of your direction throughout your films. There's the scene where there's the first kind of taste of flesh. You hold the camera. It's a single shot. We don't cut back and forth between the finger and her face or any reaction. You just sort of let it gracefully and slowly unfold. Can you talk about that scene in particular?
Yeah, I agree. With this specific moment, it was obvious that time was the only thing that we needed at that moment, especially if you really want to escape the trope of a horror, gory, scene. That would have only had shock value. I obviously do not care for shock value at all. And I think that in order to understand and to stay with her, we had to understand. In order to stay with her at that moment, we needed to understand her. And the only thing that could lead us to understand her was time. And also, for me, to really understand what steps she was going through every time. For example, it's really, you'll see, if you see the scene again, you'll see how compartmentalized it is. So basically, she has like this finger in her hand, all right? But she never planned to eat that finger. It's not like it's not a crime. It's not like she had premeditated her act or whatever. All I want to talk is impulse. Impulse, impulse, impulse. And taboo is all about impulses, obviously. So she has this in her hand. And what she wants to do is to preserve that finger in ice so that when the ambulance comes, they can stitch it back to her sister's hand, which we would all do, all right? So she's looking for ice. But this is a shitty co-ed apartment. So there is no ice. And the fridge is empty anyway. So there is no ice. So what do you do? You're looking for a bowl or something. Well, there is no bowl. Why would you make it easy on your character, right? There is no bowl. So, okay, what I'm going to do? I'm going to just fucking sit with this finger in my hand waiting for the ambulance. Up to now, we all agree that considering the circumstances, that's what we would have done, right? Okay. So she has this finger in her hands. But there is a lot of blood, okay? There is a lot of blood, I mean, it's a severed finger. And the blood starts, like, dripping on her. But the thing is that if you're eating pizza, and the ingredients go, like, above the crust, and they fall on your lap, you don't want it to fall on your lap, so the first thing you're going to do is go. This is impulse. This is reflex. This is stupid reflex, you know? It's just your body. It's a gesture that you are used to. If you have some, I don't know, some milk or OJ running down your wrist, you're going to go like this, because it's milk or OJ. Well, it's blood. And it's human blood. And the fact that she tastes that, which is actually, if you want to like make some very, very stupid link, is not very far from the apple in the Garden of Eden, okay? She does this out of a human reflex, but that's the trigger. That's the thing. And that's when, you know, you have to like really compartmentalize all these moments, truly think about them. What would I have done? What is the common sense in all that? What is the normal reaction in order for me to get you with her? If you had seen her like really binging on the finger right away, you're like, who's that crazy woman? You know? So I have to stay at her level and at your level, all right? And then it's only time. It's like she does this, the trigger is done, and then you let it last. And you wait until what you think is gonna happen happens. And this is when you need time.
Yeah. Yes, and Hitchcockian, because that's the nature of suspense. We know what's gonna happen, it's just a matter of when.
I planted it in your head, yeah.
So you just talked about how much you're paying attention to the body. And you're paying attention to the body too in your casting. And I think it's something I really notice in your films, because sometimes you see films where clearly casting is about the way an actor delivers dialogue or the way that their facial expression works on camera. But for you, your characters are embodied fully. Can you talk a little bit about that? And when you're casting, what you're looking for and the movement and the physicality that comes in for you?
That's very interesting. Of course, because there are so few dialogues in what I do. It's actually tricky when you have to rehearse, and even in cast, it's tricky because I don't have much to give, you know? I mean, there are really few dialogues, so obviously it can't be based on that. It was all the more interesting with Agathe for Titane, because obviously her part is even more mute than the rest of the other characters that I have in my films. And also because for this specific part, I wanted someone who was not an actress or actor, and someone who had never been seen, on whom we could not project anything. So what do you ask for them in casting, you know? So obviously, I worked a lot with improv. But when you do improv, which is already something super hard to do for like a trained actor or actress, for someone who hasn't done anything before, obviously you're not waiting for a wow performance. If you're waiting for that, then you didn't understand what the point was of your casting. So what you're looking for, I think, is for me, it's really the energy. I don't know how to say it. It's the way that person contains their energy. I would feel that in that moment, someone I'm really like thinking right now. I mean, it's far ago, but I think the people who were out too much for me at this moment were people where I thought it was gonna be difficult for me to actually draw. Because you have to draw, you know, not only the character, but also the actor or the actress, you know, because they have never done anything before. So it's like you have to not only create a character, but you have to also create an actor or an actress at that moment. And I think it's really a lot about a form of being almost feverish somehow, something that is quite internalized and yet strong. So I would say that in this particular aspect, for this particular part, less was definitely more, definitely. Not to say that the best ones that I saw did not do anything, on the contrary, but it's really you're looking for someone who has like obviously terrible charisma, like something terrific, sorry, it's a Frenchism. In French, terrible is a good thing. sorry, terrific charisma. And the sense of their own lines. I'm sorry, because you were talking about bodies earlier. And for me, there is a lot of things with contours, of the contours of our own bodies. That's something that I talk a lot about, the fact that, you know, that the impulses make your body over, you know, over leak or in the world, you know, that go like, I don't know who you say that. When you have a glass and it's too full, how do you say that when it goes on the board?
Yes.
Yeah, that spills over the world, exactly. and you kind of want to create those contours, you know. The thing with Alexia's character is that she is the way she is at the beginning of the film because she has no contours, because her impulses are spilling all over the world constantly because no one has ever looked at her. And when you look at someone for real, when you acknowledge the presence and the existence of someone, you give that person contours. It's a little bit the same when you cast people who are first-time actors or actresses. Mm-hmm. You know, because like the first time they are being looked at in this context through a camera lens. You know, you give them this kind of contours for the first time, and that's what you're looking like, someone who can actually have these contours. I don't know if it makes sense. It does for me, but, you know.
No, absolutely. It makes sense, and it's... Yeah, I think it's interesting that you talk about Justine Garance and sort of keeping the audience with her versus you start out in a very different place with Alexia, in a place where we're instantly repelled by, even in the car scene where there's this hatred between her and the father, the first scene is in the car. And so instantly we're in a place of like sadness, fear for this girl, and then when she hugs the car, there's a distance between her and the rest of humanity. Mm-hmm. So was that scary for you to be like, I've worked in Raw where I'm approaching the character to the audience, and now I'm starting out where in a place where I'm instantly creating this division?
Oh, it was terrifying. It was terrifying because it was really, like, honestly, it was a little bit of a poker game, because I was, if I don't manage to keep your attention long enough for you to want to see more of her, then the audience is going to leave after 20 minutes of my film, and they're going to be like, I don't understand that person, she's crazy, bye. You know, so how do you relate to someone that's virtually unrelatable? That's really hard. And it was even harder when I was writing the script, because I've always had a sense that it had something to do with her body, and that it would show in my mise-en-scène that we can like organically feel her, even though we don't understand her, we can't relate to her for the moment. But how do you translate that in a script? And how do you convince people that, no, I promise, mm-hmm. we're gonna stay with her, they're gonna stay with her, because it's like it's just a script at that moment. So how do you convince people of the importance of what's organic, you know, in terms of creating a bond between a film and the audience, when you don't have the morality with you, when you don't have the history of the character with you, when you don't have anything for the character, nothing was working for her at the beginning of the film. She was she was really just death impulse, and no one wants to see that, you know? So yeah, it was quite terrifying, but at the same time, I was very, 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 very aware of and convinced that this is what my film require in order to reach not only her meeting with Vincent, but to reach to the end where we have the true birth of a new humanity, which is obviously the baby who is born, but her humanity as well, her becoming a human. I wanted us to see someone becoming human under our eyes. Mm-hmm. And what does it mean exactly becoming human? So I had to start with someone who was quite inhuman at the beginning. But it is, it has been very, very, very tricky to do, for sure.
It's, yeah, I love that, becoming a human, because in your films, something thematically that we see is, you know, people talk a lot about gender in your films, but what's interesting is, to me, it's more about convention, and people, you know, the convention is sort of dictating aspects of our lives. And there's this, with Alexia, she actually puts on a uniform to receive love, in a way, because she wears this uniform to hide herself as a boy, and that's when she's accepted into this family. So I just think about freedom and convention and conventionality in your films, and I'm curious how you think about those when you're writing.
You're talking about the freedom of my characters?
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, I think all my characters are free because they mutate. Mm-hmm. So for me, this is really like the most cinematic expression of freedom in movement. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like you can really like shedding the skins for me means also very much questioning you as a person, and also and pushing you forward, you know, in a forward movement. And again, to the unknown, like not I want to become this, but just I want to become. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, and that mm-hmm. and that's the only important thing. Mm-hmm. So I do believe, and in that respect, I think that my films are quite optimistic. I do believe that all my characters are, in the end, confronted to their freedom. I think in Raw it's interesting because at the end we don't know if being confronted to that freedom, knowing that she suffers from, let's say, a predetermined impulse that has been like going through her genealogy, but her father tells her that she has a choice and that he knows that she's gonna make a good choice. And we don't know the end, and the film ends here. So at this, what I like about this ending is that we don't know if realizing for the first time that you're free is a good thing or not. Mm-hmm. I think it's an interesting question.
It's fascinating. I want to make sure we have time to talk about collaborations. You have Ruben Impens, who's been your DP on the last two films. And I want to hear about how you work together and what that collaboration is like.
I'm laughing because I love Ruben so much. We have a very complex relationship.
And I should be clear, director of photography, cinematographer.
Yeah. The first thing I'm going to say about Ruben is that I've always been a huge fan of his style. I think he's an amazing DP. Mm-hmm. I'm saying this is quite narcissistic for me because we have exactly the same taste. And there is really something with us that we're always like, we have the same ambitions for what we want to do. And it's really quite amazing how fast we can agree on the direction we're going to take on the film. But it's not only because we have the same taste. It's also because Ruben is like this amazing reader. The way he reads script, honestly, it's pretty rare for someone who works on image. The way he reads script is really insightful and really, really precise and refined as far as the story and the characters are concerned. And there is one thing that he always does is that he puts the film before his image, basically. For him, everything has to help the film. Help the characters, help me say what I have to say. And the fact that he thinks like that, which again is a very rare and smart thing, honestly, to do, and I really bless him for that. The fact that he thinks like that helps both of us to push our boundaries with what we want to do. And we can be so, like, we can be so cheeky, we can be so, like, you know, when you think you're, like, the coolest person in the room, like, yeah, let's do that. Let's fuck everyone. We're going to do that. And you're like, we're so cool. It sounds stupid, but yeah, there is a childish part of that job, honestly. And thank God, that's why it's so cool. So, but the fact that it's also because he's so incredibly helpful and mature in the way he apprehends the script. And he's someone who really works on project that he chose, that he like, and who just loves telling stories. He doesn't just love taking nice pictures, or he doesn't just love lighting a good shot. He loves telling story. And I must say, he's as much of a storyteller as I am. And that's what makes our relationship, I think, so profound and rich. It's because the both of us, we always think about the characters and the story first, before we decide that this shot, because, you know, it happens sometimes, like we set a shot and stuff, it's kind of like distributed that way between me and Ruben, that he's with the light a lot, and I'm very much into the frame. Mm-hmm. And he lets me this space with the frame, which I'm really, really, like, grateful for, because for me, it's something that really helps me write my story, the frame. But when we end up with something really cool that looks cool, but we're like, what does it say, really? If it doesn't say anything, if the conclusion is that it doesn't say anything, we just don't do it. We go for something simpler, but that is just, like, way more, you know, closer to the characters. Like, it's always like we really push ourselves, not trying to be the cool cats.
Yeah.
You know?
How much of this happens in prep versus is happening while you're shooting? And can talk a little. Sorry, how much of this is happening in prep versus when you're shooting? And can you describe your prep process?
It's both, actually. It's like we do quite a bit of prep with Ruben, both of us. So basically, what I do is that I do the shot list. Not the entirely, but like I do, let's say the first 10 sequences, whatever. And then we meet. I tell him what I want to do, that. And he says, yeah, I see what you see. I don't get that shot, though. Don't you think that this could be a little bit better? Why don't we add a movement here? What? You said, like, Dolly, but isn't this Stead? And I'm like, oh, I hate Stead. I'm like this. And he's like, no, but, you know, in the perspective, maybe Stead would be better. And we just, like, dialogue over, you know, the shot list that I have, that I've come up by myself. And it's just like how to make things again better and better and better through dialogue. And the same with the light. The light, the moment where we talk about the light, it's a nice moment because it's like coming up with references and stuff like that. Our references, weirdly enough, are not very often films. Mm-hmm. They're most of the time paintings and sometimes photographies. Mm-hmm. But I must say that we both have something with paintings and with art. So we talk about this a lot. We send each other references for paintings and stuff like that. We discuss about the painting, what we like in it. We discuss about the contrast that there is in this particular painting or whatever. But that's really that's a part of the research with this. And then he comes up, like, maybe I could do this, maybe I could do that. But the thing, what I want to say is that my prep, whether it's with Ruben or the rest of the crew or my shot list, is always very, very thorough. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I couldn't go on set if I didn't have a steady prep. But I'm a very strong believer that the more prepped you are, the stronger your shot list is, the more you can improv on set. Because basically, when you have prepped so much, it means that you know where you're going. You know what you're doing. And so when you get on set, you know what you're going to say with that shot. You know where you're going to. You're not like looking for it for hours, like looking at the birds or whatever. You're like, you know what you're doing. You set it up and you go, that's a downer. That, yeah. Nope. Mm-hmm. No, that's not going to work like this at all. Not at all. Okay. But when you know what you're doing, you can find a way that is very fast, very quick to get closer to what you want to do on set. Because for you, it's not a mystery. It's not like you're looking for your shot. It's just that your shot has been found. But now you have to just make it happen for real, because what you had planned doesn't work. And I've always worked like that. I think this is something, honestly, that comes with, I've done a lot of ballet dancing when I was a kid and piano. So I have this kind of like very traditional, you know, artistic upbringing. And both in ballet and in piano, basically, you cannot do anything, you cannot interpret anything if your technique is not on point. You can't do anything if your technique is not on point. And I think it works for everything that is artistic. In order to really interpret something or to express yourself fully, you have got to know the basis and you've got to know where you're going. Mm-hmm. I apply this to myself.
You are so ambitious with what you're trying to achieve on set. You have prosthetics, you have real effects, you're dealing with these scenes with tons of actors. Can you talk about making that work, and is it ever falling apart, and how do you know when it's really working?
Because there are a lot of elements in your question. Alors, it does fall apart sometimes. Again, when you're prepared, it's not so it's very stressful, but it's not scary. When you're prepared and you know that your crew is prepared and that you have trust and faith in your crew, then it's very stressful because you know you're going to maybe lose a bit of money because it's going to take more time to redo everything and stuff like that. But it's not scary, though, like, oh my God, where are we going? What are we doing? Okay. So, like, for example, in the end, the last scene in Titan, the birth of the baby, was a little bit of a shit show at the beginning. It was very funny because originally I wanted to shoot with a real baby, okay? And so we casted real babies. But the thing is that in France, I don't know how it is here, but in France you cannot work with babies that are younger than 5 months old. Have you seen the size of a 5-month-old baby? I mean, the guy can talk. He can go to the bank. I want my checkbook, all that. Like, and when I saw the four babies waiting for me on set the day of, I saw that. Like, what is that? And like, I don't want that. They look like Buddha or whatever. They're huge. They were huge. Like, I mean, if that went out of her, that my film says a whole other thing again. I mean, it's like, the hell. So, but I was a bit sad because the babies were really cute. And I was like, oh, I'm firing babies. I'm a monster. And so that didn't work. And so they were like, yeah, but we have a fake. I remember my head of prosthetic effects was like, yeah, but we have a fake baby that we had pinned just in case. So he shows me the baby, but the baby's like, I don't know how to, so it's dead. It's pretty much dead, you know? Now, but I can paint it a little bit so it looks like less dead. And it looks dead. I don't know what. And honestly, I started panicking a little bit because that was a very big scene. And it's the last scene of your film. I mean, come on. And what are we going to do? So I go with the CGI head guy. I mean, what can we do? What can we do? Are we going to do really a baby in 3D? Or what are we going to do 3D? And I see the face of my producer. Do you know how much it is to do a baby in 3D? It's crazy. I mean, it's crazy. I mean, by our French budget standards, it's crazy. And it was not planned at all. And so I'm like, okay. So we take the fake baby, they cut it open to put some like metal in it that were supposed to be the spine and stuff like that. And so basically my both the head of prosthetics and the head of CGI came to me like, okay, we're going to do a mix of both. Okay. We're going to play with the dead baby for now. And and then afterwards we'll make it in motion without having to do the full 3D. We'll make it in motion afterwards in post. So actually, that was a good idea. I'm glad, honestly, they united their forces and came, because really I was on the verge of nervous breakdown. I was like, and so that worked. But the funny part after that is that how did you direct Vincent Landon, who is a very, very famous actor in France, but who's very much used to incredibly realistic films and like social dramas and stuff like that. And you tell him, okay, you're gonna have to play love with a dead baby. And I think he had never played with a prosthetic before, but like that much, like something that is that obvious that it's nothing you can actually relate to. It's just dead plastic. And it was like, it was really like, he's first like, but what is it? What's like, I mean, that's a baby. I don't know what is that. So all in all, it was supposed to last one day. It lasted two. We lost some money in the end. The result is good. Thank God Vincent is a genius, because these tears that he gives when she gives birth are really one. They were the first take that we did on that, so he's really brilliant. But Vincent, he's funny. He's like, the thing with crying, he can, like, the way he, it's absolutely insane the way he does it, because it's not like someone who, you know, some actors can do it actually naturally, like physically. They know how to trigger the lacrimal glands, and they can cry like this, you know, which is great and super helpful on the set. No, for him, it's really about conjuring the emotion, but he does it the same way someone would do it mechanically, because he goes like, okay, 2 seconds, father. And that's it. That is so impressive. I mean, it's like 45 years of career. I mean, that's amazing. The guy is a genius.
Very sadly, we've gotten to like 20% of what I wanted to talk about, but we only have a few minutes left. So I wanted you to talk about, you know, we talk a lot in the US about like how the sky is falling around movies, and, you know, cinema box office is down, and things have really changed after the pandemic. Where are things going with movies? What is your hope for sort of the future of movies and for French cinema in particular, knowing that you're part of a continuum in French cinema where you're breaking ground in many ways? There are very few celebrated genre French filmmakers. And sorry.
My agent is like, he's laughing at me like crazy in the first row right now, because that's the trickiest question ever. I don't know. I mean, we can't sugarcoat the situation. It's impossible. It doesn't mean we can't have hopes and all that. I think, again, for me, everything stands in our capacity to adapt. And that's really something that is that's my philosophy in life, to adapt constantly. I wouldn't be able to talk about French cinema per se, but just talking about the general state of art. All I can talk about really is art, because to be really honest with you, I don't know much about numbers, and I know that everything's crashing. I mean, that the industry is crashing, like in every country at every level. But I think somehow, for me, where I feel more endangered, let's say, is the way art is crashing and is considered nowadays. This is something that is very much of concern to me. Like, for example, it happened with me. With my films, you're gonna say with my films, it's normal, but I'd rather like keep it to my own experience than try to make a broader statement. But like, for example, some people seemed at one point to think that I was a cannibal, or that I wanted to kill people or fuck with a car. Yeah, that sounds stupid, right? But unfortunately, I think that nowadays people tend to expect from films to reflect exactly what the person is in real life. And from my point of view, we are not mentors. We are not there to impose anything. For all I know, we are there to raise more and more questions constantly, but we can't do that if we are like, if people, let's say, ask from us to portray only, let's say, good, optimistic. But at the same time, I'm going to tell you something. It's a bit, it's a tricky question, so I'm really trying to say what I want to say in a simple way. But I want to say that I understand where that comes from, this need. Okay, it's not something that I think it can be in the end pretty damageable, but I know where it comes from because the world we live in nowadays is so dark. And why I think people want to break from the world, and that cinema used to be able to bring that break from the world. But I think that maybe the state of affairs has come to such darkness that maybe it's not enough anymore. And it makes me very sad. But at the same time, I'm pretty sure that there is something irreplaceable in what we do. But when I say we, I can talk as well about the museums, about exhibitions, about concerts. Is that it just brings us together, and it helps us talk together. And we cannot let this disappear. We're fucked if we do, because this has always been. If there is a purpose, and again, for me, there is no purpose in art other than make us come together and talk. If art is cancelled, it's the end of civilization. It's a pillar of civilization. And that's where what I'm scared of. Yeah.
So honored and grateful for you sharing what you shared with us today.
And thank you.
We're so happy to have you with us in Austin and for inspiring our community of artists here and beyond, and all of you who've come here for South by Southwest. Thank you for being here. So we might have a few tickets for T-Town, like walk up, like at the last minute. It is sold out, but if you really want to try, you could. We'll see you tomorrow night. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.